because she taught me how to use Prezi last fall.
As we're getting the presentation pulled up, I just have a little brain warm up and looking and wondering. So I'm going to pass around a couple feathers. Take a look at these. Think about yourself as you look at them. What kind of bird you think they came from? You might know, you might not. What's the function of the feather? What purpose did each of these feathers serve? There's three different feathers. And maybe what location on the body of the bird do you find them? So just take a look at those as I'm telling you about my spring.
There is that.
Thanks. At school in the woods. I get to spend the spring at school in the woods. And before I tell you details about that program, it's really unique. I want to tell you my entry goals going into the program, what I really wanted to get out of this. So starting out, I wanted to learn as much as I could about how school in the woods works and what the program was like. I'd spent a half day there in the past. I knew a little bit about it, but I really wanted to get in, learn the nitty-gritty details, the history, how they work on a day-to-day basis, their schedule, and get to know that. I really also wanted to build an understanding of school in the woods as a full year academic experience for students. So I also had an outdoor education background, and that is in a program that had 3, 4, and 5 day experiences for the students. School in the woods is the entire fourth grade academic year. So I wanted to see and experience and work through the process of implementing curriculum and meeting standards on a full year basis for students. I also wanted to find and understand what were the areas of need at school in the woods. How can I meet those, and how can I bring my skill set and my background to build the program? And that flows right into my next goal, which was to really start the foundation for continued partnership. There has been some connection between CC and school in the woods in the past, but I was, similar to Wilma, the first person to get to do an internship experience there. And I really wanted to lay some foundation, and that goal grew more important as I learned the schedule change, because I think there needs to be continued partnership between our two programs. Finally, I wanted to have a blast growing and becoming a naturalist. So all the fourth graders at school in the woods, we addressed them as naturalists for the whole year, and I wanted to become one with them. So a little bit about school in the woods. It is located in Black Forest, up north of Colorado Springs, northeast. It's on a 640-acre plot in Ponderosa Pine Forest. The property is totally undeveloped except for the buildings that are there for the school. So it's really right in the woods, literally. And it's part of District 20. It's an experience for fourth grade students. So there are 3 classrooms of students that get to go, 26 in each. So there's 78 total students for the academic year. And they all come from different elementary schools if they get selected by the lottery system to go there. They attend for the full academic year, and then after the year's over, they return to their previous elementary school. It is not actually its own entity. It's part of Edith Wolford Elementary, but it operates really independently. And it has a really small staff, but everyone is super invested and works really hard to keep the program running. And the teachers teach through a focus on interconnections and the interconnections that exist between different subjects and through nature, and among all the things we can see and observe and measure and record in nature. It's really cool to see that. I have a ton of pictures. I really had to pare my pictures down, so I'm going to try and show you as much as I can, because there are just so many amazing things out there. The campus, to start out, portable buildings are what are still out there. These are 17 years old as the school. I think maybe a couple of them were in previous use before they were put on this property. But they're hopefully going to get a new building in the next couple of years. This picture is also what School in the Woods looks like on May 1st of this year. Yeah. We got some snow. It was great. There's a solar array there, which is a really awesome teaching tool, and it also happens to power the building. Really cool coincidence. There's a garden that's been developed and built over the years, and we care for that, grow plants, and actually garden and harvest and eat them every Friday. This is the outdoor lunch area. We ate out here every day, except unless it was actively snowing or raining. We were outside. In addition to the Ponderosa Pine, there's also a ton of number of different riparian areas, waterways, where life is abundant. And these are really great places to study the diversity that exists and the relationships and the interconnections of the ecosystems that are around. Wikitown. So this structure is called a wiki-up. And Wikitown, I will tell you a little bit more about later. In addition to the outdoor natural resources, there's also every classroom has many things you would find in a traditional classroom. There's also a large meeting room where all three classes of students can gather, and we do that regularly, twice a day. In that meeting room, there's some different areas to document meteorological data, astronomical information, and we track that, record it, and chart the changes that happen. Number of other resources. First and foremost is nature. That is the biggest resource that we use in teaching. And we get outside, it's really easy, just one door and you can take the class outside, as opposed to having to gather the class, walk down the hallway, go down some stairs, and then be maybe in a parking lot area. So it's really just the access is amazing. And there are outdoor classrooms that make it really easy to teach outdoors. The students, the naturalists, are really adept at learning outside. It's not just go outside, oh, it's recess time. It's actually a learning time. Even when it is recess time, we are learning outdoors. There's also some technology, computer lab. There's a really high-end meteorological array that's on top of the buildings that feeds into the local news networks and provides information for news reports for Colorado Springs. And we track that information firsthand, which is really cool. The students love doing that. There's a pond on the property. It's like a 10-minute walk from the buildings. And again, a riparian area that has a flourishing of life. We study the pH of the pond also to look at what constitutes a healthy water ecosystem. And then numerous other tools to help us observe and learn about nature. So what does it look like a day in the life at school in the woods? For me, one of my goals was to try and find the needs for how I could integrate myself into the program. And part of that for me was just becoming a naturalist and getting into the rhythm of their life. And so I'm going to tell you what I did. One of the biggest important foundational aspects that I think I brought my skill set to at School in the Woods was this huge community growth and community bonding, in a sense similar to HMI. That's a really foundational aspect of becoming a naturalist, is all these students come from different schools around District 20, and at the beginning of the year, they don't know all the other students, but they get to be great friends. And part of that is through this morning meeting. There's also an afternoon meeting. To keep the M&M acronym, it's a marvelous meeting in the afternoon. We meet in the meeting room, all of us, and every day we talk about a number of different things. We have routines and traditions that we go through. One of those is saying the Pledge to the Earth right after we say the Pledge of Allegiance. So it goes like this. I pledge allegiance to the Earth and all the life which it supports, one planet in our care, irreplaceable, with sustenance and respect for all. Whoa. So if you are teaching, you can use that in your classroom. Check it out. It's online.
It's online?
It is online. It's not just a School in the Woods thing. That was a cool teaching tool for us. Another really big part of this community involvement was the jobs that naturalists had. So there is a separate job for every single student and in each classroom. They rotated each week, so they had their job for a full week, and then they taught the new person next week how to do their job after they rotated. So this sense of responsibility was huge for them. Jobs consisted of things like refilling bird feeders every day, taking care of the plants in the greenhouse, and a lot of other routine tasks, checking the bathrooms at the end of the day to see if they were clean, tracking that data that I mentioned earlier for astronomy and meteorology. After that meeting in the morning, there's a math and a literacy block. I'm going to be a math teacher next year, which I'm excited about. And I got a chance to work closely with the math teacher to learn a lot of techniques from her and input my skills. And one of the things I did was just go outside as much as possible, because I love being outside. And so anytime there's an activity that could be taught outside, I would take it out and work with the students. And also, working with a math teacher, we started trying to figure out how can we teach through nature. So finding different aspects and different items in nature we can use to teach about math. That was really valuable as well. With literacy, as I mentioned earlier, there's this really strong interconnection across subject areas and in nature as well. So we are closely studying Lewis and Clark and also Bent's Fort, which is some local Colorado history. So looking at those two subject areas, talking about how can we teach reading and writing, but also science and social studies and math through these two units. And I got to work with students closely, design some lesson plans, and try to create more of that intercurricular connection. Recess and lunch, important at every school, but even more so at School in the Woods. The students rush outside. There wasn't a day that we didn't go outside for recess. Even those couple days where we came inside for lunch, we still went outside for recess. Many things to do, one of the most important being WikiTown, which I mentioned earlier. So these WikiApps are structures of logs and branches that are shelters. At the beginning of the year, students get to build them themselves, and this becomes a special place. They have ownership of a WikiApp, and they create this barter trade system using corn cobs for currency, and it's just an amazing culture that they have out there. After we got to visit Bent's Fort for a field trip, and we came back, and the next week I was wandering out during recess, and they had constructed a replica of Bent's Fort, and they were play-acting Bent's Fort. Really, really cool to see their growth in play. And then lunchtime is eating together and sharing a meal is a really important part of community, and we raised that level of awareness for students as well. One of the really important parts of my insertion into the School in the Woods life and the teaching was during spring field projects. So after spring break, every single afternoon, the entire afternoon block is devoted to students getting to go out on a spring field project. And they get to choose from a variety of options to become an expert in a certain field, an area of study in the field based on observation. So I got to lead and work with the birding group. I knew a little bit about birds before this, but now I know a lot about birds. we learned really anything you could want to know. Nests, beaks, eggs, feathers, flight. There's so many different ways you can take that topic, and that was amazing thing to experience. A lot of the learning was based on outside field observation. Making observations, the types of birds that live in Black Forest, what their lifestyle is like, and recording that data and charting the data, tracking it, and seeing what we could find. One of the tools that was useful for this process was bird boxes, which are scattered around the property. And they're really smartly built, where you can actually tilt that side panel open and look inside to see if there's nests or eggs and check the progress once you discover that. I also got to bring some teaching tools that I have collected over my year as an MAT. And one of the things I really wanted to do is try and measure students' growth over the course of the unit. And so I gave them an entry assessment and just asked them to sketch a bird, label the parts. This is the first day of spring field projects. And so I saw, you know, kind of standard wing, tail, ear, eye, and I'll show you the end result a little bit later. School in the Woods is a really unique place. It was a meeting point for me between my background in outdoor education and my year learning about teaching and being a teacher in the MAT program. And one thing that really is going to stick with me is the ability to be in awe of nature and of our surroundings and our environment. And we our class took 5 minutes after our math block every morning to just stand outside and observe and quietly listen and wonder at the beauty of nature. And that was one of my favorite times of the day. I also got to really bring my enthusiasm and my love for learning. So one of my favorite lessons that I implemented was learning about eggs and talking about the different parts of the egg. And then the students got to take chicken eggs, and we cracked them and dissected them and looked at those parts in person. And then I collected all the eggs in a bowl, and we scrambled them up and we ate them.
Great.
And Craig got a double yolk, and he was psyched. So over the course of my time at School in the Woods identifying the different places where there were needs for School in the Woods, and also trying to figure out how I wanted to use it as an opportunity to grow. So these are the five areas that I found growth for myself and the program. First of all, with students, I was able to come in and add my teaching expertise, my love for being with students and being outdoors and teaching through nature. And this is the end assessment.
Whoa.
An amazing drawing of a skeleton with all the bones labeled. So cool, that blew me away. I also saw a really great growth learning and teaching through the interconnections of nature. I mentioned it already a number of times, but looking at anything that you can find outdoors, female ponderosa pine cone, and thinking about how can I teach a writing lesson or a reading lesson or a math or a science or a social studies lesson all about this same thing. And students see that all those lessons connect, and they see that nature connects, and that all processes as they're learning. School in the Woods also has a really unique connection with the community. They have a number of people. Almost every day we had a different community expert come and help teach the students. And seeing that and the amazement and the engagement that would happen as students learn from different experts was really eye-opening for me. And that's one thing I'm going to take to my classroom next year, to whatever I do in the future, is to try to continue to bring in these real-life experiences so the students can see people that are actually out there taking what we're learning about and using it. The responsibility that students had with those jobs and also with other standard things like homework or tests, these naturalists had some of the most self-sufficient responsibility levels I've been exposed to at a fourth grade age level. They were awesome. They would just take a task and run with it. And that was something else that really is going to stick with me from this experience, is that when you give responsibility to students, they will take that and they will grow and they will become stronger with it. Finally, a group celebration of growth. As we accomplish things and experience things together, the community is a really strong foundation for that learning that occurs. And celebrating growth together is huge. So this is the end of Earth Day, which we had a really amazing Earth Day celebration at school. And additionally, kind of my final reflection, the biggest event that happened right at the end of the year and the final evening of the final day of school was the end of year ceremony, because after this year is over, they all split up and return to their original elementaries. And so we have kind of a really meaningful celebration experience. And I got to put together four different songs that I played while all of the students sang, and I sang along too. And we performed those for their parents and other community members. And that was really just awesome to see. And I'm going to be teaching at a middle school next year in the same district, so I hope that we'll get some naturalists in the next couple of years. Questions? Yes?
Just what type of, I know it's kind of hard to say because some of these students, you may never see them again, but then again, this is Colorado Springs, you probably will run into them. Mm-hmm. But growth in the students. I mean, I know you showed the examples of the birds run before and after, mm-hmm. but can you see where that experience may have changed the life of a student? I mean, give them a greater sense of purpose, or you know, just give them confidence in areas they didn't know they had.
I think I saw that for many students there. And the responsibility in those jobs were a big way that came across, just seeing them be able to step up and be responsible for something and take care of it every day. But also in the learning process, this has also been part of my outdoor ed experience, teaching through nature. There were a number of students in the classroom that were fairly troublesome students as far as behavior and focus. I had one of them in particular in the birding group with me, and he got so into making field sketches of birds, and he loved that. He would never turn things in on time for my birding group, but he would bring in a new sketch almost every day and show it to me, that he would make it home every night. So seeing the process of getting really engaged by whatever the material is we're learning and taking that and being excited about it in their outside of school life. I think that's one thing that happened for many students.
Thanks.
Yeah. Yeah, Mary.
Since you're licensed in secondary math, like, I have a two-part question. What made you want to work with fourth graders, and what did you learn about working with fourth graders that might apply to older students?
Yeah, my licensure actually kind of went in reverse, in that I was originally doing elementary, and that's what my master's will be in.
Oh, okay.
And then while teaching elementary, I got psyched about math, and then got the math course.
Okay, I wasn't up to speed on your whole development.
So, yeah. So that's where I'm at, but I'm now going to be teaching 7th grade, which is kind of meeting in the middle.
Yeah.
So I love working with the younger age group, but I also am excited to be able to specialize my teaching and my instruction and hopefully continue to try and get outside. The school I'm at does have an outdoor classroom, so I want to try and make the most use of that as I can.
Cool.
Yeah. Yes?
In the beginning of your presentation, you mentioned about lottery system employed, and I'm just curious about what kind of like balancing, you know, was really happening in the student selection, you know, including the SES students.
So it is a totally random lottery. It's completely random. There are two founders of this school. One of them still works there. His daughter did not get in, so. They don't take any consideration or anything. It's just completely random. Good question. Yeah.
How did you find that having the sort of large outdoor component? I guess when there was still time in the classroom, how did students respond to those two factors? And were you faced with a lot of, oh man, I want to keep building my fort, you know? I want to keep going out and, like, looking at water, because obviously those are really profound experiences for students that can be really hard to emulate in a classroom.
Mm-hmm. My first response to that is that this school, being only 3 total classrooms, is super flexible. They're not on any sort of bell schedule, so if we were out at the pond, like 10 minutes from the buildings, and we were just really into it, and we all had our radios that we kept with us all the time, we would just stay out there and keep going, which is a really part of that school. But additionally, I think the students also, in the process of becoming naturalists, I was there in the spring. They'd been there for the whole school year before that. They had gotten really well used to being outside and being able to kind of shift while they were outside or going back inside. But I think they had the ability and seemed to be able to shift direction fairly well and smoothly.
Yeah.